Hello and welcome to Wine Blast with me, Susie Barry, and my husband and fellow master of wine, Peter Richards. And on this podcast, we're not afraid to ask the big questions, sometimes about the little things.
Well, size isn't everything. I'm just going to leave that there as a metaphor, physical notion, rather than following it up in any meaningful way. So, okay, so I've got a question for you.
Oh, go on.
What do Oppenheimer, COVID-19 and wine all have in common?
Oh, right. Well, Oppenheimer is the guy who I now know helped develop the atomic bomb because there's a film out about him at the moment. But as for a link with COVID-19 and wine, I'm not sure I'm getting the connection, so you're going to have to enlighten me.
Okay. Well, it goes back to what I was saying about size not being everything. The power of the micro. Tiny, invisible world all around us, which can prove to be devastatingly powerful. So the atomic bomb was all about harnessing the immense power of atoms, of course. COVID was an invisible virus, but which caused a global pandemic and reminded us, I guess, in the process, the viruses are the kings of our planetary jungle, far more than we are. And they're not even alive anyway, but moving on. And then perhaps to a lesser extent, but still in an important way, we're just starting to learn and appreciate how important this invisible world of microbes is to wine.
So from Hollywood to global pandemic to wine microbiology. But no, I mean, you're right.
It's a straight line.
You're right. But I mean, this is important stuff because I think as humans, we tend to focus on the big things that we can see.
Yeah.
You know, the macro, which in wine would be the rocks, I guess, and the vines and then the barrels stuff and the bottles and the winemakers. But we probably don't pay enough attention or respect or give credit to the small things, the invisible things, but which are actually really quite influential.
Yeah, I mean, I think things are changing in this regard, aren't they? Albeit maybe quite slowly. You know, we're talking more and more about the human microbiome, aren't we? The skin microbiome or the mouth microbiome or the gut
microbiome, definitely gut,
much more relevantly. You know, which we focused on, didn't we, in our episode with Tim Spector and how wine can actually be good for our gut microbiome, which was great news, obviously, with Tim, what was it, officially advising us to drink as widely as possible? Hundreds of different varieties, I think, was the
within quote. Moderation, which is slightly disappointing.
You can't have it all, can you? But anyway, you know, when people talk about terroir and its influence on wine style and quality, they're often talking about soils, the big thing, soils, and maybe then climate primarily, partly because that's what a lot of the textbooks and the experts say. But, you know, while we wouldn't dismiss the broad concept of terroir or wine's amazing sort of propensity for diversity, I'd say we increasingly question what influences it.
Yeah, and that is where the biology comes in.
Exactly. So, you know, on one level, you've mentioned winemakers. You know, that's biology. Human intervention is absolutely crucial in this equation. But that's something that's often either underestimated or overlooked entirely, which I really struggle with when textbooks or experts talk about terroir. You know, I was just talking, we're just back from Crete. I was just talking to a very well-respected and brilliant winemaker on Crete, Gianni Economou, who dismisses the notion of site-specific terroir expression entirely. He says the winemaker is everything. He says, I can make any wine from any site. I mean,
whoa.
That's maybe a debate for another time.
Yeah,
we'll come back
sounds
to that.
Intriguing.
That's
just
sort of.
Yeah, but might I think, take a while, that one.
You know, over and above human influence, we also need to pay more attention and respect to the microbes, you know, on this tiny level, the yeast, the bacteria, both in the vineyard and the winery, and probably beyond that too. But, you know, there's some intriguing work and research being done in this field. So that's what we're going to get into in this episode. Here's a taster.
Whilst winemakers make wine, it's actually the microbes that do the hard work. In fact, most of the fruit aromas that one perceives in wine is not from the fruit. They are the byproducts of yeast metabolism during fermentation. Vineyards appear to have their own unique biological signatures. Biology, microbiology, is part of terroir.
Understanding the connection from soil to wine, but in this global scale, is one pending task for us. We have like a huge toolbox to explore.
intriguing expert words there. First from Matthew Goddard, Professor of Population and Evolutionary Biology at the University of Lincoln, and then from Ignacio Belder of the Department of Genetics, Physiology and Microbiology at the Complutense University of Madrid.
Those are some long titles and departments and stuff. It's very impressive.
Anyway, we'll be hearing more from both of them in due course. And we should just say, by way of preface for this episode, that this is part of our mini-series challenging easy stereotypes and simplistic thinking about wine, isn't it?
Yeah, so you know, we looked at the hotbed of confusion and angst that is this issue of minerality in wine, didn't we? And before that, we focused on misunderstandings about geology and soil in how wine gets rocks wrong. And in that one, geologist Alex Mormont did touch on this theme of microbiology, saying, while the influence of geology is frequently overstated for wine, the role of microbes is potentially understated, and that microbes, especially yeast, might well be playing a role in terroir. But we don't tend to talk about them much because, again, they're invisible, technical, complicated and easy to disregard in popular writing. So that's what those were his words.
Okay, so I think on that note, we should bring in our first guest. Professor Matt Goddard is Director of Research in the Department of Life Sciences at the University of Lincoln in the UK. Before this, though, he worked for many years studying the microbiology of wine in New Zealand, associated with the University of Auckland. His background is in ecology and evolution, and he uses microbes as a model system to understand that, with wine microbes being a particularly fun subject. He described New Zealand wine as a beautiful thing to interact with.
I think we'd all agree with that wholeheartedly.
We would.
I like interacting with wine on a daily basis.
We know that,
maybe in a slightly different way from Matt. So, you know, anyway, when Matt came to wine, he says there was good science on the chemistry of winemaking and grapevine genetics, but the microbiology science was quite reductionist, i.e., you know, this microbe gives this flavour. He saw what he described as a vacuum in terms of ecology of microbes. What sorts of microbes are there? Do they differ in time and space? Do they contribute to wine style and flavour? If so, by how much? Is there a role or any role of the living things in vineyards and in wineries in terms of this concept of sense of place with terroir? Or do you just completely ignore all the living things? It's just about geology and climate. So that was his thoughts. And he, you know, looked at all of this and thought, this was an interesting thing to get stuck into. And he's done some absolutely fascinating research since.
Yeah. And just a couple of things by way of preface before we hear from Matt. He mentions Michael Brykovich of celebrated producer Kumu River, who we've had on the pod in the episode on New Zealand Chardonnay, which does touch on this issue of microbiology briefly, because Kumu is well known for its wild ferments using indigenous yeasts rather than cultured yeasts you buy in packets, which are widely used in global winemaking today.
Yeah, we've used them, haven't we?
We have indeed. You're right.
We helped out during harvest at Finit in Spain. That was quite an adventure, wasn't it? And when I say helped out...
Yeah, I'm not sure we did, really.
I think we helped out in terms of reducing the size of the beer
in the fridge.
Storage. And pretty much, we're useless elsewhere. But anyway, I do remember mixing those yeasts.
Yeah,
I do too. Starter cups. Yeah. Anyway, this is important to mention, this distinction between what are known as wild or spontaneous fermentations using indigenous or ambient yeast, where you just kind of let the thing go. You harvest the grapes, crush them, and just let the thing go because there are yeast in the air and all the grapes can blah, blah, blah. And then the technique of adding cultured yeasts that are bought in. The latter are often used to give reliable, specific outcomes or, you know, and or prevent fermentations getting stuck or giving off flavours. But the story is a bit more complex than that.
Yeah, I mean, we're going to try not to get too bogged down in complexity. But one other thing to clarify is that Saccharomyces cerevisiae is frequently the main fermenting yeast of wine because it can tolerate high concentrations of alcohol and sulfur dioxide. It's also worth, I think, explaining what are termed as flavour precursors. Now, these are naturally occurring compounds in grape juice or wine, perhaps specific to a certain grape variety or place, which don't have any flavour in themselves, but which can be transformed into actual flavours or aromas, for example, by yeasts.
Yeah, also, while we're on the topic, thiols, again, we've mentioned these before, but they are, just to be clear, aromatic compounds formed by yeasts. Some are unpleasant, but the ones that crop up in these discussions are more usually positive. For example, box tree or passion fruit aromas in Sauvignon Blanc. So anyway, lots going on here. We're not going to get bogged down, as you say. But Matt is the most illuminating guide to this intriguing world. And I started by asking him to tell us about microbes and wine, because maybe this is something we don't talk about enough.
Yeah, I guess because you can't see them by definition, most people don't even think about them. But obviously, whilst winemakers make wine, it's actually the microbes that do the hard work. So there's the obvious microbes involved in fermentation. And it's a much more complex picture than just a single type of yeast converting sugars into alcohol. There's a whole layers and layers of complexity behind that. And of course, we're beginning to understand now from mapping what's happening in the winery back to in the vineyard, we're beginning to understand the importance of microbiomes in the vineyard as well, for a whole variety of different reasons. So the layers of complexity here are enormous, and how these noisy biological communities interact with a vague subjective way of tasting wine is also fascinating. And because you've got two very complex systems that in some way, as we all know, come together to allow us to perceive differences in wines from different places at different times. And so I'm trying to unpack how all that comes together is fascinating.
It does sound absolutely fascinating and not particularly easy, I imagine, either. Just tell us, you know, and not easy, I guess, to simplify for us, but if you could try to, what's your research telling you?
We started off in the winery, and the first question was simply, what sorts of microbes do you get involved in fermentation? And if you do what our ancestors did and conduct a wild or a spontaneous ferment where you don't deliberately add anything, what's there? And where has it come from? And so we discovered, working very closely with good old Michael Brykovich at Cumu River, who's himself a stellar winemaker, all of his ferments are spontaneous. And so we took all of our molecular, genetic and microbiological tools to investigate what was going on in his ferments. And we discovered that there was a massive diversity of different types of wine yeast in all of those spontaneous ferments. And none of them were escaped commercial wine yeasts. They weren't, you know, what you can buy in a packet on the shelf. They were all natural. And we were able, through investigations in the surrounding vineyards, to show that those yeasts that were driving the fermentation had derived from the surrounding environment. And so those yeasts really were part of the terroir. They had come from the outside environment along with the grapes into the winery and were conducting the fermentation. So that was the first evidence to show that spontaneous ferments are in fact conducted by things from the surrounding environment.
And sorry to interrupt at that stage, but you're talking about, obviously we've had Michael on the program, we've talked about different single, are you talking about differences in microbiology within the ferments between the single vineyard sites that he has? Because they're not, you know, that far apart, but you know, they're in the same area, but were there differences even at that scale?
We didn't test that explicitly at Cumu River, so I can't tell you.
Okay.
I can tell you from work with other estates and vineyards in central Otago and Marlborough and other places, when we've begun to investigate individual vineyards, each vineyard appears to have its own microbiome signature. So we've already showed that there are regional microbiome signatures, that, you know, Hawke's Bay is a different microbiome from West Auckland, which has a different microbiome from Marlborough, et cetera, et cetera. And so we talked about this sense of regional microbial signatures. But the work that we're just doing now is focused more on single vineyards, and they appear to be different from one another in their microbial signature.
So even in between single vineyards, there's a difference in I'm intrigued by this phrase microbiome signature, because obviously that you're making an explicit link, therefore, between the microbiome of the site and actually the wine itself.
Implicit, I would say. So what we can measure, hundreds, if not thousands, of different types of microbes in various habitats in the vineyard: soil, bark, juice, leaves. We extract DNA, sequence millions of molecules of DNA to work out what's there. So there's a massive complex community there. And then we can compare whether those complex communities are random or whether there are differences between different sites. And the statistical analysis show us there's a strong, significant difference in these communities between sites. That's in the various vineyard habitats. Now, when the fruit gets brought to the winery and is put in various containers and fermented, then how those single vineyard differences translate into the types of microbes that are there and the flavour compounds they produce is not yet clear.
But there does seem to be that difference, even on a vineyard basis, that this is impacting in some way.
It's certainly true that vineyards appear to have their own unique biological signatures in terms of the microbes that are there. The degree to which that translates through into the winery and then the chemistry of the wine, you can join the dots, but the dots haven't been scientifically joined yet.
Okay. Just then, what is primarily in the local sort of microbiome sites that might be influencing wine? Are we talking about yeasts primarily or bacteria or other things?
All of the above. So I think logically you can think about this starting in the vineyard. If there were no microbes in the vineyard, vines wouldn't grow. For nothing else, that microbes make fertile soils or make nutrients in soils for vines to grow. With no microbes, vines couldn't grow. So at some basic level, we need microbes for vines to grow. But once they start to grow, you can quite easily understand that the types of microbes that are there will affect how the vine grows and the quality of the fruit. And the clear example of that is that pretty much all grape pathogens are microbes, right? They're fungi, they rot grapes. So there's one clear negative way that microbes affect fruit abundance and fruit quality. It's not inconceivable, therefore, to imagine that the reverse is true. There must likely be microbes that increase vine vigor, perhaps, but more importantly, fruit quality. So there's some slightly abstract but tangible understanding that the microbes that are present in vineyards will affect how vines grow and the quality of the fruit. And you can easily imagine that the types of precursor molecules in fruit that become flavor active compounds in wine, microbes might affect how those, the abundances of those in fruit as well. So there's one clear example. The second clear example is once the fruit is harvested and brought into the winery, once again, it's the microbes that drive the conversion of the juice into wine. And in fact, most of the fruit aromas that one perceives in wine is not from the fruit. They are the byproducts of yeast metabolism during fermentation. And so there's a clear example there where the various microbes and the types of microbes in the ferment affect wine flavor. Now, even if you deliberately, if you try to add lots of sulfur to try and kid off the indigenous microbes, and then you deliberately inoculate with a commercial wine yeast, even in those situations, there's still natural yeast there that are growing and producing metabolites. So even in a really controlled environment. But of course, many winemakers, and especially those winemakers looking to make more distinctive styles or higher end styles, prefer spontaneous ferments because when they work, they give greater depth and complexity. And we've spent a lot of time looking at these spontaneous ferments. And we can show there that there are tens, if not hundreds of different types of yeast in these spontaneous ferments, and that each of these types of yeast are producing slightly different aroma profiles, but further, they can interact with one another. So when you've got partners in a ferment, the different partners cross-communicate, they cross-feed, one feeds a precursor to another, and that produces a different type of aroma profile. And so that's a tangible outcome that we have commercialized now. And in fact, Fruitzen is a commercial product. It's a non-Saccharomyces yeast that we found in New Zealand, in fact, in Michael Brykovich's ferments, that we show when partnered with other types of yeast elevates volatile thiols in Sauvignon Blanc. But more generally, it increases palate weight and sophistication, adds that sense of roundness. And so now you can, winemakers can purchase that. But it's just an illustration that the microbes in the ferment absolutely manipulate the wine aroma and flavour that comes out of it.
And I'm intrigued about this aspect because we don't talk about it enough, do we? You said fermentations are hugely complex affairs. We like to simplify them right down to sugar turns into alcohol by the effect of yeast. And also you said that, you know, most flavours aren't from the fruit. They're actually from the yeasts.
Most fruit flavours that one would perceive in wine are yeast-derived, absolutely.
Yeah. So are we starting to understand this complexity? I mean, you said you've commercialised a product which is really interesting. Are we starting to get to the bottom of these sort of wild yeast, native yeast, indigenous, however you want to call it, wild ferments and how winemakers can best use them to best effect?
Yes, I think, in the last 20 years, they've seen a comeback. I think in the 70s and 80s and 90s, perhaps it was suggested that spontaneous ferments were not a good thing because they would often go wrong and that wild yeasts were bad. But I think there's been, in the last 10, 20 years, been an increasing realisation that, in fact, that there can be benefits to spontaneous ferments if that's the style of wine that you're interested in. And there's been an increasing understanding and sophistication by winemakers in understanding how they can control those through temperature, various nutrient additions or not. In fact, the way things are harvested in the vineyard, so yes, I think there's an accumulation of knowledge that now is growing to allow winemakers to map the way their sites behave to the types of wines they want to get and therefore how to manage their ferments to get to that in a more robust way.
So if I'm understanding this right, you're being quite careful with what you're saying. You're saying that it's not that cultured yeasts are bad per se. It's just that it depends on what product you want to make and how to understanding how these different processes work so you can make the best product given your vineyard and your winemaking.
Indeed.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Okay. But I'm also interested in, you know, what implications do your findings about the microbiological aspects of terroir have for wine producers? What changes might need to be made to the way that people do things now because of this understanding?
I think there's a few aspects. One aspect is that this understanding of the fact that biology, microbiology, is part of terroir, and I wouldn't begin to claim it's the most important part of terroir for one second, but what I would say is the science tells us that it is a part of it. Terroir is obviously a very complex phenomena that has many things involved in it, but until, you know, 5-10 years ago, the concept of having any of the living parts of the environment involved in terroir wasn't even on the table. But now we can show it is important, that the microbes do play a role, not the most important role, but they play a significant and detectable role. Therefore, it's part of the story behind your product. And if that is therefore also true, then perhaps wanting to understand and preserve and maximize your unique biodiversity at your sites is important for not just ethical or moral reasons, but also for commercially valuable reasons. It could be that if you manage your sites in such a way to maximize the unique components of biodiversity, that is part of your sense of place that you want to capture and sell.
So does that by implication mean that things like synthetic fungicides, pesticides, herbicides are not a good idea?
That's another very good question. And we've spent a lot of time working on that problem back in NZ. In fact, we've just finished a large 6-year program where we've had replicate sites across Hawke's Bay and Marlborough, half managed conventionally with, you know, various pesticides that you might use, the other half biodynamic and organic, so really dialing down the inputs, certainly no synthetic inputs. And we've compared and contrast the biodiversity of what's there. It's complicated, as always, with biology. There is a significant effect of whether or not you, of which type of management you choose to use, but the effect of conventional management isn't as large as one might imagine, certainly for the soil biodiversity. When it comes to the biodiversity that you find above ground on fruit, then there is a marked effect on the fungal communities, but less so on all the other biodiversity. So the science is still young, but definitely the way you manage your vineyard will have an impact on the biodiversity that's there. And therefore, you should be mindful of that if you're interested in using that biodiversity to harness it in wine.
And is there potentially does this open up the door to developing treatments that might respect the beneficial microbiome while targeting the ones which aren't so beneficial?
Indeed, and I believe there are products out there already that are microbial sprays for the vineyard that I think are trying to get at that kind of concept. But of course, if the component of biodiversity that's valuable to you is unique to your site or estate or region, then of course, if you spray some random other microbe that's developed in another country, that may also not be, you might be diluting out your sense of place.
Interesting. You said earlier on that the biology is, or the microbiome is probably not the most important part of terroir. What would you say is?
Probably climate. Just you take Sauvignon Blanc and a Marlborough, you know, you can take the same clone of Sauvignon and grow it in another part of the world and you don't get the same thing. And I think that's largely due to climatic conditions and how that affects the development of a vine. Clearly, the way individuals choose to manage a vineyard, that will have a large effect on how that fruit develops when it's picked, all that kind of stuff.
I know it's a vexed question, isn't it? All of these things come together. We don't quite know how, but just in terms of relative significance, you know, I think we haven't paid attention to the microbiological aspect of terroir. So in effect, it's been zero on the scale of how important it is. Where would you put it now? You know,
I can give you a number because we've quantified it in two different experiments, and we find that about 10% of the variance in wine chemistry is due to the microbiomes. So at least 10%, and that's in controlled experiments, which is, you think, oh, it's not very much, but actually that's a large fraction.
That's very significant, especially given we haven't really, as you say, properly considered it before being an aspect of it all. Nice to have a number too. Matt, thank you very much indeed for your time.
It's an absolute pleasure.
So the microbes are contributing at least 10% of wine's character, or at least chemistry. Mm. That is a serious influence. Mm. And it's clear from what Matt says that even single vineyards have unique microbial signatures, mm. and this can then be traced through to the ferments. This really does feel like a new way of understanding terroir, doesn't it?
Totally. And farming. You know, you know, Matt says there weren't huge differences between organic and conventional farming in terms of vineyard microbial,
which I think in itself is surprising.
Which is interesting.
Yeah.
But I guess, you know, if you think it through, it stands to reason. If you're using fungicides and fungi are part of the natural microbiome, there's going to have an effect, you know, ultimately. So, you know, and actually other research I've read has shown that there's greater diversity of microbial communities in organic vineyards against conventional ones. But anyway, ultimately, as Matt said, you know, if this microbiome is part of your wine story and identity, it's important to understand it and protect it as much as possible.
But it is complex, isn't it? I mean, you know, on one level, it's easy to think of wine microbes as just yeasts fermenting grape sugars into alcohol and carbon dioxide. Simple. Mm, mm. But when you start to realise there are so many different kinds of yeasts doing so many different things, both in the vineyards and in the wines, it is slightly mind-boggling, isn't it?
In a good way.
Yeah, you know. Well, yeah. You just got to get your head around it. But part of that is these interactions with each other, which are clearly only just starting to be understood.
Yeah.
And then, of course, all the flavours and aromas and textures they generate. Mm. You know, as Max said, most of the fruit type flavours we perceive in wine are actually produced by the yeast.
Yeah. And I suppose it makes sense when you think it through, but you wouldn't. It takes a bit of head bending to actually get your head around that, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And I guess we shouldn't forget about the bacteria too. You know, I suppose particularly the classic one is the lactic acid bacteria, which perform the malolactic fermentation in many wines, converting tangy malic acid into softer lactic acid, isn't it? So, yeah, I mean, layers of complexity indeed, absolutely. You know, we're only just scratching the surface here. But I guess you could even throw in the human microbiome affecting our perception of wine. You know, the microbiome in our palates and noses and mouths may be affected by the one in our gut. I don't know. Mm. But, you know, and those, of course, will vary as well. So do we need to take that into consideration as well? I don't know.
Very complex. It is, really is. But the more we understand it, the better we can harness its powers, promote the positive bits and reduce the undesirable bits.
Yeah.
So a fascinating area of research. And didn't you touch also, I think, on geology with Matt?
Oh, yeah. I didn't have time to include that. But I did ask about this notion, following on from what we discussed in our rocks episode, this notion that geology might affect the vineyard microbiome. Matt said the geology or soil might influence pH, for example, which does have a strong influence on the kind of microbial populations in a vineyard. But he did add that there's going to be a very, and this is a quote from him, there's going to be a very disconnected line between the rocks and the chemistry of fruit, let alone the chemistry of wine. He said he'd be shocked if definite links could be made in that sense. And, you know, in his view, it's the more organic biological molecules that define fruit and wine.
Interesting. So next up, we're talking to Ignacio Belda about his research and what the future holds. By way of summary so far, microbes like yeast and bacteria are an important presence in both vineyards and winemaking. They are distinctive down to an individual vineyard level and thus play a potentially significant role in what is often termed terroir, even though this is not often acknowledged in popular wine discourse. Research is ongoing. and intriguing.
Okay, so after talking to Matt, we then went to the Institute of Masters of Wine Symposium in Wiesbaden in June, July 2023. Which we touched on in our last episode on German wine. Check it out. And there was a fascinating session there on the new frontier of wine microbiology. You also sort of almost sort of see cowboys, you know, these sort of researchers. Where one of the speakers was Ignacio or Nacho Belda, assistant professor and principal investigator of the microbial interactions and ecology lab. Can we make ourselves a title that's this long, please?
Please don't. I would never be able to say it.
Nacho has studied vineyard microbiomes across five continents and is particularly interested in how yeasts interact in fermentation.
Now, by way of warning, Ignacio's not afraid to use quite complex terminology. We also had a bit of technical difficulty with your microphone during this, sorry, but hopefully it all makes some sort of sense.
Yeah.
And we started by asking Ignacio what had changed in his field since the last IMW symposium in 2018 in terms of our understanding of how microbiology affects wine.
I think that a lot of things changed since this 2018, because the methodologies that we use to analyze the composition of complex microbial communities depends on the sequencing of DNA, and these are not really new, but you know, a decade ago, the cost of sequencing was pretty high, and now it's kind of affordable for everyone to define the composition of complex microbial communities everywhere, not only in grapes or mast, but also in your gut microbiome or whatever, you know? So, yeah, I think that in the last 5 years, DNA sequencing is kind of democratized and everyone can sequence everything. So now I was leading a project when we sequence or when we define the composition of microbial communities in vineyard soils all around the world. So we find this, like, what we call the core microbiome, the core fraction, the prevalent fraction. What are those bacteria, fungi, and yeast species that we can find in every single vineyard all around the world? And we also do it kind of similar study in wine fermentations. So this sequencing a lot of samples was just possible in the last 5 to 10 years. So yeah, a lot of things changed. So we collect soil samples from 14 different countries in all the five continents where the grapevine can be grow. And it was like 250 vineyard blocks all around the world that we analyzed, and there are other really ambitious projects now, not only analyzing as we did analyzing the microbial communities in the soil, but also in the root, also in the grapes, and also in the grape masts, so they can connect what's the connection from the soil to the grape, because there is like a lot of discussion right now. At the end of the day, in the wine, how many information from the microbes in the soil remains, you know? So I think that at this moment, we do not have like a really fine answer to that question. That is like a key question for me. If we term about this microbial face of terroir, you know? So yeah, and I think we will be able to answer this question like in the next couple of years.
So we're not really clear what effect these microbes are having all the way through. And then when it comes to wine style and quality, the key thing, we're not quite sure joining all those dots up yet. Is that right?
Yeah, I think that we have like a pretty nice knowledge about the microbiome in soil, the microbiome in grapes, and the microbiome in wine fermentations. We can discuss how there are some local, in the best case, to regional efforts to connect the soil to grape to wine. But in my humble opinion, these local observations cannot be like used to define this microbial face of terroir. So let's see what happens in these couple of years, and I think that we will have like a pretty clear picture of what's happening there. So specific research lines for the future, I think that understanding the connection from soil to wine, but in this global scale, is one pending task for us.
So the next few years are going to be exciting. Tell me, we don't know a fair bit about yeast, and I want to ask about this. There's a temptation to think of yeast as simple factories to convert sugar to alcohol, and of course they do a lot more, especially in terms of flavour. Can you talk a bit about that?
Yeah, in fact, I used to use this sentence in my presentation that yeast are not just ethanol producers, and that's absolutely true. And yes, I think that the potential metabolic contribution of all these yeasts is huge. I mean, the diversity of metabolic strategies within the wine microbiome is huge. We find yeast species that, of course, like Saccharomyces, are specialized in fermenting sugars, but we find others that can produce lactic acid from sugars, not like bacteria that produce lactic acid from malic acid in malolactic fermentation, but some yeast species are able to produce lactic acid from sugars, like Lactantia. Some others can consume malic acid or succinic acid, or some others can improve or increase specific volatile compounds such as polyfunctional thiols that are really important for white wines. And for example, in this case, it depends on the presence of one gene in wine yeasts. Presence of a gene that is named YRC7 is responsible for producing this this volatile compound that imparts this box tree aroma to 13 grape varieties. So I don't know. Yeah, I think that we have a huge toolbox to explore, and what we are working now is how to understand, because grape musts are not like beer must, are not sterile. If we add a yeast inoculum, it should interact with the other yeast species that came from the vineyard. So in my lab now, we are focused on understanding the importance of what we call the biotic interactions, like the interactions between species and how these interactions may shape the fermentation performance of the whole community.
That's fascinating, because obviously you're not just studying yeast individually, but how they interact. Final question. We people in general, wine people in particular, like to focus on the macro, the big things. We talk about soil, the geology, the vine variety. How much credit do we need to give to the microbiome, to the microbiology?
That's a pretty good question. Okay, so let's start with the general people, not only wine people. I think that in the last 5 years, the term microbiome is, I don't know, maybe one of the top market terms, but mainly for human health, you know, for the skin microbiome, the gut microbiome, the probiotics, etc. In the case of wine, since I don't know, most wineries worldwide are using industrial yeast strains. At the beginning of the fermentation, maybe the importance of the importance of the native yeast communities matters, but we have worked for years without considering this, you know, this complexity. But for those enologists that believe in spontaneous fermentation, I think that here, that's the future. We have now the technology to sequence in the winery the microbial communities in a grape mass sample. So if we know what are those yeast species that may cause a fermentation stack or a specific flavor problem, maybe you can decide to, okay, here it's not the time for this spontaneous fermentation, let's add this inoculum. So I think that for those interested in spontaneous fermentation, understanding the wine microbiome is crucial and will be possible in the next, I don't know, 5 years, in-house.
Nacho, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you, Peter.
So So the microbial face of terroir still needs more studying, especially in terms of exactly how the vineyard and fermentation microbiomes actually influence wine style, quality, etc. Which is what Matt said too, wasn't it?
Yes.
But it sounds exciting. It sounds like we're close, and this could usher in a whole new understanding of wine and terroir and, as you said, farming.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think it's one to keep an eye on and revisit. It's worth adding that another speaker at the symposium, Professor Saki Pretorius, was talking about the development of synthetic yeasts as being a really exciting area for the future. The integration of biological and information sciences, he called it, through sequencing, synthesis and altering or editing of DNA.
And I think we should say that's different from genetic modification or engineering, which is using genes from other organisms.
Yeah, as far as I understand, I mean, this did go a little bit over our heads, but, you know, I think, you know, the basic idea is to use this new technology, whether it's DNA, you know, editing, CRISPR, whatever, synthesis, sequencing, to potentially design, I don't know, ideal yeasts or communities of yeasts for more effective fermentation or antimicrobial properties, maybe, you know, potentially to help with producing low alcohol wine. And of course, just sort of generate specific flavor or textural properties in wine, as we've discussed. You know, he even mentioned potentially yeasts with biosensors. So a yeast strain that could tell a winemaker that a certain tank needed more nitrogen during fermentation. I mean, it's sort of slightly mind-bending, isn't it? But that kind of thing, that's where we potentially might be going.
Yeah, I mean, I think at one stage he said, yesterday's innovations are today's traditions. I don't know if that relates back to Oppenheimer, but this all sounds to me like there is so much fascinating work going on in this area of wine microbiology, and we're on the verge of a new understanding of it all, and perhaps starting, as we've said, to harness its power in new and better ways.
Yeah, very well said. I mean, all of which brings us to the end of this episode, if not the end of this fascinating thread. We will come back to this. By way of closing summary, though, we're getting ever closer to a full understanding of what might be termed the microbial face of terroir, how a complex population of yeasts, bacteria and other microbes influences wine from the vineyard to our palates. And we may be able to manipulate this even further in the future.
In the meantime, it seems clear that winemakers need to work to understand, protect and preserve their vineyard and winery microbiomes as much as possible. And we wine drinkers should acknowledge and appreciate this invisible side of wine more, just as we should nourish our own human microbiomes too. And we can do this by drinking good wine sensibly and thoughtfully.
Cheers to that. We'll put all the details and links from this show, including previous episodes we've cited, in the show notes or on our website. Thanks to Matt Goddard and Ignacio Belda. And of course, thanks to you for listening. Until next time, cheers.